It's fresh start time, yes indeed. We've gone through two variants of the Bear Pile Dynasty. But I do believe we're in need of a third one here. As we continue to leave our kingdoms in disarray, to put it lightly. So we'll start a brand new domain here. See how we fare. Jacksum. Yet another gifty. Over 330 goddamn gift subs from Jackson. Thank you so much. Gamow with another 5. Bear hugs, bear gifts. Thank you guys so much for that. Very kind. Really appreciate it. Thanks for the hype train. I don't know about the Barons today, man. I want to get the Counts of the East back in. How about these three? This feels right. No Barons. Yeah, the Barons have had enough. Let's do this. Chiefs of the North, Counts of the East, and the Grandees of the South. That way, at least, it's easy for me to remember what everybody is. Right. So, if you'd like to join the game, all you got to do is type !! Join, followed by your pronoun of choice, and you will be entered into a random one of these three groups. And don't worry. You got all the time in the world to do this. In fact, you're able to join at any point in the game. So if you feel like biding your time to see which group pulls ahead, you know, viable strategy, you'll still get put in a random team. But that's entirely within your rights. In other streams I'm in, we change our name colors to match the clans. That could be something folks can do if they want. That would be fun. Although I've had mixed experiences with Twitch chat and whether or not it chooses to actually present the color for your name that you've chosen. But yeah, feel free to go ahead and do that if you like. Chiefs of the North, you can change your Twitch chat name to blue. Counts of the East to purple, Grandees to the yellow. That could be fun. It is done. Let's check in on it, see if it works. Baby Hippo, purple. You should be a Count of the East, correct? Indeed you are. There we go. Is it working, says Itnyum, who should also be a Count? Indeed you are. There we go. It works. Apparently it does. It's good to see. Ion Vapor Studios blue. Yes, indeed. Cool. Well, that's nice. That's a fun little added effect. All right. I think we got plenty of people for the beginning of the game here. Let's get into it. Let's start with coronation today. What must I do? Let's get this over with. Coronation vote. What kind of coronation should be held for the new king? We do tend to throw the king into the river quite often. I'll vote for a lavish parade this time. Just to mix it up. But you do as you will. Mystic Envoy! Another 10 gifted. Lavish indeed, yeah. Thanks for getting a few more bear gifts and bear hugs out there for the new subs. Welcome on in. Thank you for a big time hype train to start the day, y'all. That is awesome. Appreciate it. We'll host a lavish parade with jugglers and fountains of wine. That sounds like fun. The coronation is a great success. Jugglers, wine, fireworks, and feasts. It has an impact on your treasury, of course, but what doesn't? Viranus! Hype train rolling. Another 5 gifted. Thank you so much. The river will remember. Yeah. Your Majesty, when you die, how do you hope the kingdom will remember you? Well, as a peacekeeper certainly seems like a good pursuit now. Let's do that. An admirable aim. I suggest over the next few years you focus on improving the kingdom's stability as much as possible. I know there's like one or two that we haven't pursued yet. I'll try to go for those next time. Now that you're the king, your first duty is to meet with the Council of Nobles. Let's introduce ourselves to the Chiefs of the North, Chief the Sheo. Another name I can't decide how to say. Feel free to correct me. Good luck in the days ahead, Your Greatness. You'll need it, dealing with us a lot. Count Poxborn of the East, an honor to finally make your acquaintance. May you escape the doom that befell your predecessor. And Grandy Madman. Looking fly as hell, brother. May the Ninth God bless your reign, Your Holiness. I trust you will conduct yourself with honor and faith. Now is your time to rabble, by the way, nobles of the various regions. If there was ever a moment for you to rabble. Welcome new folks. Yeah, I'm really excited about the fact that so many of the YouTube folks are showing up for the live stream to play with us. Welcome. Good to have you. This is a very fun game. Looking forward to playing another round. Louisa of the Dapper Dogman Dynasty. That just sounds good. Powerful Eastern Order. Leans delicately on a podium, sighing. My fellow counts, in ancient times, the East was its own proud kingdom. We can bring back those days of glory, but not while the false King Baer wears the crown. What scheme should the counts pursue to place their preferred claimant, Louisa, on the throne of the Dapper Dogman Dynasty? They could also look to raise stability. They could try to lower their own faith or lower their own defiance. Again, this one's only open to the counts of the East. Looks like they'll be aiming to raise stability along with the king. Understandable. The counts plan to hold the king hostage in his own palace. First, they must lull the spymaster into a false sense of security. To advance their scheme, the counts must raise stability to 5 or more in 4 seasons. Estrid of the Fenrir Spawn clan, notorious northern elder, stands precariously on a longhouse crossbeam, droning as if in a trance. Chiefs of the North! We all know I should be on the throne, not this imposter, King Baer. How do we make that happen? That's a good name, isn't it? Yeah. Very fitting indeed. And if you're just joining us, like you can see in chat there, !join, followed by your pronoun of choice. That'll get you into the game, won't it, Taffy?
Baby girl, what you doing? Hello. Good morning. You waking up? Oh no, cutting the cable. Boop.
The Chiefs of the North will be looking to raise their own military in pursuit of Ragnarok once more. Wibble wibs. Thank you for the 32 months. Welcome back in, Baer hugs, please. The Chiefs plan to make an alliance with the Ice Giants again, because that worked out pretty well last time. Looking to raise their military to 5 or more in 4 seasons. Zenaviva of the Dr. Love 24/7 lineage. Hell yeah. Well-known southern prodigy stands bathed in sunshine, speaking softly. A false pretender occupies the throne while my claim is ignored. Grandees of the South, this is a stain on our honor. We must not allow it to go unanswered. What scheme shall the Grandees of the South pursue to overthrow the new king? Can you scroll the noble list a bit for those without the extension? Sure. Here's a quick look at our chiefs. Take a peek at our counts of the East. And finally, our grandees of the South. who are looking to raise their own farming. Off to a pretty good start there. The Grandy claimant Zenaviva has been chosen by the Ninth God to be the next queen. She's promised a first miracle, food for all. To advance their scheme, the Grandys must raise their farming to 5 or more. And there's another quick look at the various pursuits. Again, the chiefs looking to raise their military to at least 5. Counts at the east looking to raise the kingdom's stability to at least 5. And the false pretender Zenaviva looking to raise farming to at least 5 for the Grandys. Let's see. We haven't done a lot of anonymous voting. I don't know if that necessarily is going to change anything, but I'm willing to give it a try, just for the heck of it. See if maybe people feel like being a little sneaky today. As is tradition, each region offers a selection of elite guards. Think carefully, these guards' loyalty will be divided between you and their region. We have learned about all the various offerings now. What foreign mercenaries do you suggest? A band of fearsome fighters from the Tatterlands called the Battle-Bitten Brethren. Well, I'm going to have to decline based on name alone, and I'm going to have to consult with their leader and really, like, have a long talk with them about name selection. They specialize in bodyguard work, but they're costly, and hiring foreigners will betray a lack of confidence in our kingdom's fighters. Yeah, I don't know. I feel like that's probably a waste of money, and that piss everybody off and spend all the treasury. Yeah, no thanks. Lowers my authority, too. That sounds like a terrible idea. You know, we'll go with the Northern Warriors today. Works for me. The warrior heroes arrive a few weeks later. They swagger in with big grins and bigger axes, belching and singing and roaring out unsavory jokes. One of your courtiers faints. Let's get that courtier out of here if they're going to faint at this fucking sight of the guy. I don't know if they're necessarily cut out for this work. Your Majesty, this is an outrage, says Chief Shambling Turtle. Grandy Doc Dennis is trying to steal my bear from under my nose, not my bear. Did you say bear? It's not their bear. I was about to buy this beast from an adventurer in the Tatterlands when Chief Shambling Turtle turned up shouting and raving about Skurinorn. We've got this one already, right? The northern goddess of medicine and knowledge. The bear wears her mark upon her brow clear as day. I suppose this is a matter for the council. What should be done with this potentially sacred bear? If it's sacred, Chief Shambling Turtle should have it. Finders keepers, Grandy Doc Dennis can have the bear, or encourage a bidding war between the two nobles. Kaitzander! This is my real-life sister, ladies and gentlemen, so I'm going to need just an absolute flood of bear nice, followed by an activation of the channel point reward for nice. Please. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's do it. I mean, I know what I would do. This did actually seem like a good time to use anonymous voting. I was thinking about it. Can let some folks betray their kind. Although, to be honest with you, unless you're really deeply studying the emblems of your various nobles. Not a lot of information revealed here anyway, right? That one just sort of seems meaningless. Voltrum! I think with the 17 months, welcome back in, appreciate it. In a furious back and forth, the nobles battled it out for ownership of the bear. Eventually, Chief Shambling Turtle wins out. The Tatterlands adventurer is delighted and goes away with more money than she knows what to do with. Defiance can't possibly go lower for the chiefs, but that's all a Shambling Turtle's wealth gone. The Grandys aren't happy to have lost their potential zoo exhibit, but there's little they can do. The bear turns out to be a fearsome creature with bright white fur and intent green eyes. And she's vast. Even on all fours, she stands taller than a wagon. She's transported north slowly and carefully, sedated by special herbs and followed by a stream of worshipping villagers. Chief Shambling Turtle is delighted that Skirnorn's will has been done. Faith lowered via that action, but of course can't go much lower than zero. Your Majesty, this year we will be holding the Winter Feast in my clan hall. It would be an honor if you could attend. What's that? 10 days of drinking, eating, fighting, competing, drinking, singing, stamping, drinking, and drinking, Your Majesty. All will take place at the coldest time of the year as the snows bury us in, but you won't need to wrap up, Worm. That's what the whiskey is for. I look forward to it. Winter Feast, a special time of year. I don't like that you said you'll see at the end. I was feeling comfortable until those last two words. Auction time. The chiefs can increase their military with a fortress or their trade via the Thieves Guild. Counts able to either increase or decrease stability via the library or prison, respectively. Grandees, the aqueduct to increase farming of the theater, to decrease authority. As described right here, the way to fund these buildings, !fund, followed by the corresponding letter, followed by the amount you would like to contribute. If you're curious, here's a quick overview of the richest nobles from each region. Not a lot of money to distribute now, and I'll remind you again, do try to be a little more conservative with your wealth, especially early on here, as it is the one variable that you have the most control over by far. I just love that we all have weapon shields. Yeah, those custom emblems for everybody are really fun for sure. And I assume as a premier/premium user, you are able to customize that, right? Which is fun as well. Yeah, that's neat. The aqueduct has been funded for the grandees, increasing their farming. The chiefs have funded the fortress to increase their military. And there we go. Surprisingly, no stability increase there. Not enough from the counts that time. Yeah, people were holding on to their thousands till the very end there. That was sneaky. Your Highness, there's a particular forest in the south that nobody's allowed to enter because it's owned by the king. If we cleared it, it could prove valuable as a pasture for cattle or growing crops. Right now, it serves no purpose. Oh, so I own a whole forest? Several, as a matter of fact. You have exclusive hunting rights over them, but you never visit. I've petitioned the council to transfer ownership. Nothing personal. Should the King's Wood be given to Grandee Comrade Barrick and turned into farmland? Grandee Comrade Barrick is allowed to buy the land if he can afford it. I don't mind that option. You know what? I'll just make that my preferred choice. Oh boy. Oh man. I think I need to stop looking at these options as though y'all will choose anything but what is clearly the best choice for your outcomes, because of course you will. And if that's going to be the case, I really ought to be exercising my veto more often. What do you mean, Bear? We're just trying to protect your woods. You're right. You're right. I'm sorry. Yeah, you're just being kind. By the ninth. When would you ever visit the stupid place, Your Majesty? You barely leave the palace. That's a fair point, but they are my woods. Yeah, that's what the veto's for. I know, I gotta be using it more often. And the twisty passages of your castle, your mother joke. Yeah, we've seen it. Come on now. Give me anything. Show me what you got. Apparently something has escaped from the cellars of Countess Kaitzande's castle. Sydney, what'd you let loose? I've asked for an eyewitness report from a local. Hello, Your Majesty. It was a right unholy sight. A monster stitched together from parts dug up from the village cemetery. I recognize my Aunt Edna's earlobes. You used his Aunt Edna's earlobes. We specifically said not to do that. Bring me Countess Kaitzande. This creature is my life's work, Your Majesty, and my son. His escape was regrettable. He just wanted to see the village up close. Rest assured, I have chained him up far more securely in my dungeon to ensure this won't happen again. It's too late for that, Countess. You and your unholy creation must be burned. It is the only way to cleanse the world of your evil. What should be done with the undead abomination created by Countess Kaitzande? Burn both Kaitzande and her monster. Burn the monster, but let the Countess live. The monster may live as long as it stays imprisoned. Free the monster! Free him! He's a good boy. I'll let you vote anonymously so you don't have to assign your name to it. We must let him live. It is the world that is cruel. Thus! That's a good name. Thank you for the 2 months. Welcome on back in. Get him some bear hugs, please. Thank you for the prime.
What you doing?
Did you hear me say Thus?
And he said, what was that? Who's that? That was loud. Who's your chopper?
Free the monster! No, Your Majesty, the boy is not ready for freedom. This will end in disaster. The council would free this unholy monstrosity? And allow its twisted creator to go unpunished? What kind of message does this send? You're all mad, you'll see. Doom will come to the east. Doom! Unfortunately, the High Inquisitor's words prove prophetic. The abomination snaps after relentless bullying from the suspicious village. Well, it's your fucking fault. It goes on a spree across the east, torching the fields and murdering peasants, all because they called him mean names. It's finally brought to justice by an angry mob. The common folk mock you for allowing your soft heart to blind you to common sense. Won't be the first time. Or wasn't the first time, won't be the last. Let's be honest with ourselves.
Oh.
The chiefs invest wisely in local breweries, making 500 wealth. The other nobles gain 200 wealth. That's a crazy coincidence, chiefs. It just turns out we passed a new prohibition tax. So, yeah. Gonna need a little bit of that there money from you. Thanks. And yeah, the East is the East is looking like they're maybe a little too rich as well. Got a few extra coins in their pockets. I don't know, though. We're playing a dangerous game with that level of defiance. I think we better just sit pretty right here. Defiance, that's cordial. You know, they understand. They get it. The king needs his money. I am a hungry bear. Our wondrous bear is thriving in the north, Your Greatness, just as Skurinorn would wish. The Godspeakers have gained visions of new herbs and medicines ever since she arrived. Thank Morgana. Time for the real questions. Is she adorable and fluffy? She is an avatar of one of our most powerful deities, Your Majesty. Of course she's adorable and fluffy. But yes, she is very fluffy. The only thing is that she's eating a lot. Our hunters have to push into the frozen waste to find enough food to go around. Having second thoughts, are you? Perchance the bear would do better in a nice cozy menagerie, huh? Sacred bear has put a dent in northern food supplies. Can the council help? Let's see. Is there anything here? I think I'd like to veto this. seems like my best bet. Shall the northerners be left to their own devices? Or will the treasury be responsible for importing fine meats for these beasts? I don't think so. The chiefs dig into their deep stockpiles, but it's not pleasant living off fermented seal and dried fish for months on end. As the chiefs grow hungrier, so does the bear. An ominous statement. Three potential matches. Let's see who we get. This is Torgir, firstborn son of the northern Naki Cappuccino clan. He's your typical northern lad. Big, brawny, and honest, in the same way an axe to the face is honest. Strangely enough for a northerner, he's an enthusiastic convert to the worship of the ninth god. He was already engaged once, but it didn't last. No one's sure why. This is Zenya, the eldest daughter of the Eastern Tanderstrike dynasty. Not sure why the artist made her look so severe, just a trick of the light, perhaps. Spends most of her time indoors, poring over musty tomes. She's obsessed with her family's legacy. And finally from the south, Kitano, the eldest son of the Basmith lineage. He's reputed to have an ego the size of the sun, but there's nothing wrong with confidence, right? He's been in more duels than I can count and won them all. All his duels have been practiced, he says, for a final showdown on the horizon. What do you think? Of course, by picking a candidate, you'll anger the other regions, but you'll gain a lifelong alliance. It does seem as though I should favor the southern candidate in this circumstance. Grandies of the South. Appease them a little bit here with Kitano. I'll make the arrangements. Although we're just sort of flip-flopping the defiance around there, aren't we? Winter Feast. After weeks of leading your baggage train along perilous mountain roads, you finally arrive at the snow-swept clan hall of Chief Calmquat. The hall is crammed with all the chiefs of the north, sitting cheek to cheek along tables, groaning under the weight of food and ale. It's just well described. Welcome, Your Majesty, to my humble hall. Take a seat, grab a drink. It is customary at Winter Feast to exchange gifts with the host. What did you bring? Great question. A casket overflowing with sapphires. An axe with an emerald-encrusted shaft. A champion warhorse. Or some fine silk pajamas. You know what? A casket? Overflowing with sapphires? Increase their trade? I don't know if I need to do that. But that could open up new possibilities. That is very expensive, though. Let's just go with the axe. What extraordinary craftsmanship. Useless as a flagon full of seawater, of course, but it certainly looks pretty. I'll make sure all the chiefs know of your generosity. After that, the feast lasts long into the night. The fires roar, the bards sing songs of the old days, and a lake of ale is consumed. A couple hours in, you are extremely, extremely drunk. The chiefs appreciate how much you're getting into the spirit of things. They roar with laughter at your mumbled jokes. Someone claps you on the shoulder so hard, your crown falls into your beer. As Winter Feast draws on and the snow piles up outside the doors, the mood in the hall turns raucous. Your memory is blotchy, but you distinctly recall, absolutely I would lead the entire hall in song, no question. The chiefs roar alongside you, full-throated, as you sing the stirring battle songs of the north long into the night. When you wake the next morning, you find yourself sprawled out in the hall. Calmquat is sitting beside you, eating some bacon and eggs. You really got into the swing of things last night, Your Majesty. Mighty impressed I was. Didn't even think you knew the words to some of these songs. To be honest, Your Majesty, you might have gotten too into the swing of things. Break it to me gently. You sang some songs that are very aggressive toward the other regions. The kind of songs that rhyme pillage with village. Word spreads quickly. Accusations of northern favoritism become a thorn in your side. You bid farewell to the chiefs and begin the long, perilous journey back to the capital. This is a rational response. You know, they didn't overreact. Fair enough. We can tweak the laws. A call for unity. That seems like a good idea. Plus one stability if more than 50% of nobles vote for any one option. I'll take that. Rampage! Your Majesty, Chief Shambling Turtle has been eaten by the Bear of Skurinorn, Rip Shambling Turtle. I thought that would happen. You did? The North just didn't have the food to support the poor creature. The bear is holed up in a cave deep within the mountains, Your Majesty. Chief Shambling Turtle's family demands justice. From the bear? Should the chiefs take vengeance on the bear that ate Chief Shambling Turtle? Of fucking course not! What's wrong with you people? Why is this even a debate? Don't kill the bear. Do I have to say that? Call for unity. Come on now. Let's at least have our laurels by which we can rest on. Our laurels we can rest upon. There we go. That's how you phrase that. Nice to see we can leave politics aside. I feel like in some circumstances, we can see past the need for political advantage. Come on now. Leave the bear in peace. Goodness. The bear hides in her cave, and though Chief Shambling Turtle's family vows revenge, they don't dare to attack. After all, she's still sacred to Skurinorn, no matter how many chiefs she consumes. Well, there we go. That is a stable society right there, too. Your Highness, I regret to have to bring this matter to you, but there's no other way. We've been tracking a northern criminal who's wanted in conjunction with a number of high-profile incidents back home. We thought she'd slipped the net until recently when we discovered that she'd fled into the south a number of years ago. But the Grandees are refusing to let us investigate further. Who is this criminal? We don't know her real name, but the common folk call her Widowmaker Ellie. She's lied, cheated, and murdered her way halfway across the north. Wait a moment, are you talking about Old Lady Ellie? She's a pillar of the community back in Haranza. She arrived a few years ago from the north and used her wealth to invest in local businesses and set up an orphanage. Everyone loves her. Surely you jest. Old Lady Ellie, this woman is a bloodthirsty criminal and must be punished. Should Old Lady Ellie be extradited to the north to face justice for her past crimes? Let me think here. If we were to send Old Lady Ellie back to the north... No, I don't want that. I want to allow Ellie to stay in the south under the protection of the Grandees. I'm going to veto this. See how that plays out. Unsurprising. Yeah, you take away the chiefs and the counts. Logical option. They're going to go ahead and default to the other one. Ooh, that is a valid point, isn't it, Zen? Yeah, I hadn't really considered that when I vetoed the other one. Lowering the authority that much would be pretty concerning, too. Maybe this is the best option anyway. Summon her to the capital to answer to the king's justice. When Widowmaker Ellie arrives in the capital, she looks like any other sweet old lady. The sort of woman who gives local children candies against their parents' wishes.
How can I help you, dearie?
She looks 25. Come on. I've seen enough. Execute this criminal. How do you plead to Chief Kid Cool 563's accusations?
Oh, dear. I am afraid Kid Cool must have mistaken me for someone else. I swear by every god there is, Your Highness, I've never pillaged anything but my pantry.
Like, I was on her side, but that's clearly a rehearsed line. She's stood in front of the mirror thinking to herself, okay, they're gonna catch me at some point. The king's gonna question me. I gotta have like a go-to sweet old lady line. They hear that and they're like, oh, shucks, she couldn't have done anything. Never raided anything, never pillaged anything but her pantry. Nah, that's suspicious. Why do you have the same name as this outlaw?
Oh, well, there's lots of people from the north called Ellie. It's a very common name. Even my mother was called Ellie.
Wait, your mother? What did you do when you were younger?
I worked in the mines. It was long hours, taught me humility.
Well, why'd you move to the south?
I always liked it there. The people are so delightfully, different.
Nice save.
And they love orphans, just like me. Have I mentioned I love orphans? They remind me of myself. I was an orphan for as long as I can remember.
You were an orphan since birth, but you know your mother's name. I was gonna say, suddenly Ellie's face shifts. She adjusts her posture, standing up straighter and stares you right in the eyes. All right, you got me. I'm Widowmaker Ellie. But I'm reformed now. See, ask the orphans. Are you really reformed, though? Do we have any orphans to ask? No, Your Majesty. We didn't think it was really important to bring any along. You really think your good deeds wash out the bad? I hope so, Your Highness, or else I wouldn't have done them. It's all much of a muchness, really, though, ain't it? I've already admitted I'm the one Kid Cool was looking for, that pompous idiot. So what are you going to do with me? Well, I mean, you're sort of just asking me to cut your fucking head off, so I'll do that. I'm glad justice will be done, though I'd prefer it if we had in the north had been able to pass this sentence. When the watch approach Ellie, she reassumes her previous persona. She bends her back, puts on a smile, and then fake hobbles outside to face the executioner. Later, you hear the Capitol had seen some light rioting over your decision to execute a nice old lady. Yeah, that makes sense. Your wedding to Katana was naturally the talk of the kingdom. Nobles and peasants alike travel from across the realm to attend. For a week and a day, the capital is one giant party. Feels like you're the only one not taking part. Instead, you're getting ready for the ceremony. Soon enough, you're standing in St. Bertrand's Cathedral with Katana at your side. I do take this man as my lawfully wedded husband. Hooray! Bear clap. After the wedding, of course, there's a feast and a dance, and your new husband delivers a long, rambling speech that puts everyone to sleep. Fun. By the time you find yourself alone with Katana, it's past midnight, and you've never felt so tired. What a wonderful occasion that was. A shame that tradition demanded we marry in St. Bertrand's Cathedral. I can assure you, the temples down in the south are much grander. I hope you're not feeling homesick already. Of course not. I never get homesick, actually. I can't abide people who waste time dwelling on the past. That's a little, hoity-toity. Tell me something you're passionate about. Well, I'm a champion fighter. Never been beaten in hand-to-hand combat. Each of my fingers has a kill count, actually. That's so interesting. It is, isn't it? Anyway, to continue on the subject, you gently fall asleep to the sound of Katano droning on about himself. Sounds like I made a great choice. Far in the east, Countess Chotokana is hosting a dinner party in her castle with a few distinguished guests. Our plans are going better than expected. The spymaster thinks that all is well in the kingdom, and while the cat's away, the mice shall play. And when the cat returns, it will find the mice has poisoned the kibble. The analogy's a little tortured now, but I like the enthusiasm. Our next step is to replace the palace watch with our own agents. Indeed. The honor guard are incorruptible, but the watch are another story. If the king can't pay them, they'll look for money elsewhere. The counts must lower the treasury to 1,500 or less in 2 seasons. Far to the north, where the snow blankets the landscape and wolves howl in the night, the chiefs plot to bring about the end of the world. Ragnarok prays Morgana. Initial talks with the ice giants are going so well, they've gifted us a new patch of fertile land in the northern valleys. The gods are good. With this luck, this will be the foundation of an alliance strong enough to rock the world. The ice giants are a formidable ally, tall as a building, limbs like tree trunks, and the southerners don't know how to fight them like we do. But first, we must offer something that farmer. They gotta do that, right? Yeah, we already seen this one. Yeah, they gotta raise the trade to combine total of 12 or more. It's the other region's trade to a combined total of 12 or more, which is currently at 10. So there you go. The prophesied Ninth Herald is finally manifested on Celeste Ath, taking the form of a humble noble known as Zenoviva, who hails from a farming town in the southern hills, or so the grandees claim. Peasants all over the south are flocking to you, Zenoviva. I knew you could do it. The plentiful crops have been a significant boon to our economy, and that's what I call a miracle. Praise be, but this is just the beginning. With him on our side, we will capture the minds of the common folk and lead a holy crusade against the false king. The people still need a push, however. With just the right amount of chaos, the peasants will take up arms and die for you. For the next stage of their scheme, the grandees must lower stability to 4 or less in 2 seasons. Oof. Those are some difficult goals. For once, I feel like I actually have a chance. I might be able to pull this one out. I just gotta keep paying attention. All right, here we go. I don't mean to exaggerate, Your Majesty, but I believe I have pioneered the most incredible invention in the history of mankind. I was hosting a small party playing cards with some old friends. I called for a servant to bring me something to eat that was both tasty and convenient as my hands were occupied. What my servant brought me that evening will change the world forever, Your Majesty. Show me! Behold! He holds in the air a plate. Atop the plate are 2 slices of bread with a piece of meat wedged, between them? What is this sorcery? It allows the hungry noble to consume 2 slices of bread plus meat all at once. Saving valuable time. Meanwhile, the bread serves as an impregnable barrier, preventing one's hands from being besmirched by meaty juices. Ingenious! Naturally, since this is my invention, I propose we name it after me. In a few years' time, I expect everyone to be enjoying a nice Zen Furo for lunch. But naturally, this innovation cannot be made available for free. Every time a Zen Furo is consumed, I expect a small royalty payment. Should Zen Furo receive royalties for the consumption of a Zen Furo? This is one of the better votes I think we've had so far. Let's take a look. Yes, give Zen Furo the royalties he deserves, which of course we could assume would decrease defiance for the grandees, increase his wealth, and decrease trade. It's an interesting choice. Zen Furos are too delicious to be controlled, increasing defiance and increasing trade. Zen Furo shall receive a one-time reward from the treasury instead. Oh my. I don't like that. The servant should be rewarded instead. What was his name again? What do I do as king? It does feel like I ought to veto something here. In fact, it sort of feels like I need to veto C. Just to make damn sure that doesn't get through. That one would kill me in 2 ways. Ooh, split decision. I got a lot of respect for these 9 votes. Chief Calmquat, Nemerite, Hey, Viranus, Lord Balkan, Orion, Start Select Gay, Fortunes Gray, and Modular Sonobe Origami. I don't know if I said any of those names right, but they're all worthy of respect. they all made the right choice. Not Bill Murray. What is the answer to life, the universe, and everything? Subscribing to BaerTaffy for 42 months, obviously. I'm glad you finally discovered it for yourself. Enjoy enlightenment. And thanks for the bear hugs, too, y'all. Thank you, Your Highness. It's the least I deserve. Now to work on my next invention. Edible playing cards. From that point forward, everyone is forced to pay a small fee to Zen Furo whenever they eat anything between two slices of bread. Other grandees are granted an exemption from paying this toll, but chiefs and counts are forced to cough up. Some chiefs and counts' wealth has decreased. Consequently, despite the deliciousness and convenience of eating Zen Furos, it never really catches on. Bakeries go bust across the South. That went well. Ah, Baer, I have something I need to discuss with you. That oaf, Chief Picaros, challenged my honor, calling me a coward, only fit to fight training dummies. I must regain my honor by fighting him at once. What are you talking to me for? Go fight. By the 9th, I will give him a good kicking, not to worry. The very next day, Chief Picaros is summoned to the fighting ring for the much-anticipated duel. Are you ready, Kitano? I shall enjoy putting you in your place. Well, I mean, not really drawn either way here. I'll just stay quiet. You bite your tongue and watch nervously. The two combatants circle each other like lions, their swords drawn and pointed at each other. When they finally come to blows, the fight is over almost as quickly as it began. A quick parry here, a thrust there, and suddenly Chief Picaros is holding up his hands in a display of surrender. Well fought. You win. Kitano looks positively jubilant. He has proven his skill and vindicated the family name. Cool. All right, that was anticlimactic. Your Grace, a monster has been stalking my farms at night, smashing down the doors of cottages and feasting on the peasants inside. Sounds ghastly. Only a few have seen the beast and lived to tell the tale. The survivors tell a garbled story about gleaming fangs amid a mountain of blood-soaked fur. How should the council deal with the monster in the east? Ooh, boy. Send the count's army to deal with the abomination. Offer a substantial bounty on the monster. Or this is no concern of ours. Reminder, the grandees aiming to lower stability here. Well, I know what to do. I'm feeling pretty safe here, in fact. I'm having myself a good year. As any attempt to destabilize is almost certainly going to be met by a call for unity. Instead, we will offer a substantial bounty on the monster. The bounty is placed. Hopefully some enterprising monster slayer will claim it soon. Yeah, hopefully. That was a nice honk. That was satisfying. Auction time. Chiefs can vote to either increase faith or authority. Counts have the option between farming and military. The Grand Bazaar can increase trade, or the prison can decrease stability. Oh, what is the prediction? I didn't actually see. Who's going to win this round? Oh, we haven't found out yet. For once, I think I actually have a chance, which is fun. I'll issue another reminder here. Do be very careful with your use of wealth. Because it's the one element you have by far the most control over. Also, something I should remind you of, as I was reminded of it last time, is the fact that you can contribute multiple times to multiple buildings. So long as you still have the money. The fortress will be constructed, along with a prison, an increase in military for the counts, and a decrease in stability for the kingdom. About your heir. Your marriage to Katana has grown strong and steady. It's high time you thought about an heir. I'm very happy with the royal wedding. Let's find ourselves a bastard child lying around somewhere. Now, my husband and I'll have a child together. The traditional method, that's what they call it. That's exactly what they call that. Your Majesty, a blacksmith in the south has come up with some sort of printing contraption. Instead of relying on the painstaking effort of scribes, it produces 100 copies of text an hour. Books are boring. By the ninth, Your Highness, don't you see the potential? I see the potential. I saw it the previous two times, too. Let's see how the nobles feel about it. Are there any of these that I feel the need to veto? This would be an increase or decrease in stability. Increase or decrease. No, they're both decreasing authority, which is interesting. Well, try for that again. Unsurprising result. Found our church simps again. Come on, guys. A little stability bonus for Baer. You're going to regret this one day, Your Greatness. Ignorance is the only thing keeping the common folk in line. Nonsense, you're just jealous. In the end, both are right. The North develops a thriving publishing industry. But as more and more books are printed, radical ideas start to spread. Ideas like, maybe peasants deserve rights, and should we even have a king at all?
Uh-oh.
This simply can't go on, Your Majesty. These arch-boffins think they know everything, but they know nothing of the Ninth God's wrath. Please, Your Majesty, we've found a perfect site for an observatory, high in the southern hills. But it's on Grandy Erd's lands, and she refuses to let us build there. Such things are heresy. The stars are just as big and close as the Ninth God intended. Who put you up to this idea, I bet it was one of those counts, like today. Should the scholars be allowed to build an observatory on Erd's lands? Let's see. Erd being the Grandy in this case. Anonymous voting. Just for fun. And it does seem like that option is not really making an impact. Looking like we're building an observatory here. Support across the board for education. The Grandees grumble and groan, but construction goes ahead. Over time, the observatory provides new jobs and brings many traveling scholars to the area, paying for itself many times over. Well, that stinks. Increased trade for the Grandees. I do not want that. In the darkest depths of an eastern forest, Countess Chotokana has gathered her fellow plotters around a mossy stone obelisk. Some of our bribes have been accepted, but not enough. The king is paying the palace watch well enough that their loyalties aren't easily swayed. So we have some of the watch in our pocket. Is that enough? No, not yet. We can't make a move until we're sure we won't be discovered. Gotta lower that treasury. Back in the north, Chief One Happy Chipmunk is hosting yet another feast at his clan hall. Not everyone is in the mood for celebrating, however. No developments, I'm afraid. The giants aren't willing to commit. Not yet, anyway. What's the problem? They leave their brains in the ice caves again, or are they too scared to take on a measly king? Nay, not enough plunder. We must make the other regions bigger, juicier targets. Indeed. Deep in the south, the grandee paces along the balcony of their hillside villa. It's just not enough! The peasants love Zenoviva and believe the miracles, but they won't rise up to put her on the throne. Take heart, grandee, we are at the threshold. The peasants need only a small push. If only we could engineer that push. We're gonna just get a little bit of extra money out of these guys, and then maybe a little extra money out of these guys here too. Yeah, that seems pretty nice. That seems pretty good. Maybe we send a little bribe the count's way. Well, no, actually, it doesn't make any sense at all. They're looking to lower the treasury. Hell, I should do this. Oh, Baer, you monster. Do you dare? Tax everyone fairly. Yeah, you know what? That's an excellent justification. It's equal. It's equal levels of cruelty across the kingdom. The eastern winter has been especially cruel this year, Your Majesty. I can still feel it in my bones. Ha! You counts don't know the meaning of the word cold. Your Highness, this is no joke. I've found the secret is layers. It's not just about me. In the east, the river's frozen and people won't work for fear of frostbite. My butler touched an iron fence post and lost his entire finger. Should the council send aid to the east in these cold times? Send food to build eastern stockpiles. Send northern troops to clear snow and ice. Order the chiefs to send any surplus food, or leave the counts to deal with it. Definitely feels like I gotta veto that. I ain't paying for it. F that, dude. No thanks. The North seems pretty confident in their ability to take care of this issue. As they should be. I do worry about the possible benefit that'll have for them. But I suppose we'll have to find out what that's going to be. Northern mercenaries soon arrive in the east and get to work. They clear vast swaths of snow and ice with shovels and pickaxes. Oh, no. Though the air is still chilly, the eastern peasants quickly grow more confident about leaving their homes, sure enough. That provides them with the exact benefit they needed. Soon, merchants can come and go more easily. Markets set up again, and citizens waddle from stall to stall wrapped in huge furs. The east is well on their way to recovery. Gotta find a way to lower that trade. Your Grace, there's been a terrible fire in the city of Dobituk. Dobituk? Where once there were buildings, there's now a field of smoldering ash. Dozens of lowborn have died. What caused the fire? Some soldiers stationed in the city got drunk and were fooling around. They tied a burning stick to a cow's tail as a prank. But the beast went mad and ran through the city, setting 100 fires. Poor cow. I was hoping the council might unlock some funds from the treasury so we could rebuild. I bet you'd fucking like that. What should be done about the burned down city in the east? I shall call for unity. Rebuild the city exactly as it was. Rebuild in stone rather than wood. Offer no help. Or find and punish the soldiers responsible. My goodness. Oh boy. This is... Yep. Is it enough? I do have the power here, and I choose to exercise it. However, it is dependent upon a collaborative effort. For if we rebuild in stone rather than wood, that is more or less a guarantee of the success of the Count's scheme. But if we offer no help, there's at least a chance. But I suppose this will have to be it. Wow. The rebuilding process will break the bank and take much longer, but fire should never ravage Dolby Touch's sturdy stone buildings again. Well, there goes all the money. Remember when I thought I had a chance? A monster slayer named Vogan asks permission to appear before the council. The bounty on the monster in the east has been collected. He steps forward, a gaunt figure in a hooded cloak. With a sneer, he tosses something at your feet. A blood-soaked head tumbling across your nice, clean floor. You're a monster, my liege. That's no monster! That's Count Smith of Lie's head! Murderer! Murderer! Care to explain yourself? Count Smith of Lies was the monster who has been terrorizing the East these last few months. Last week, I hunted the beast down, found it feasting upon the remnants of some unlucky peasant. Damn creature loped away before I could kill it, so I followed at a distance. The beast made its way back to a grand keep. Before my very eyes, I witnessed this bloodthirsty beast transform back into Count Smith of Lies. Why should I believe you, given this guy's weirdly fitting name? You have no reason to lie. It was some kind of skin shedder, no doubt. A nightmare beast that lived within Count Smith of Lia's skin came out at night. He had no memory of his crimes, I am sure, but the only cure was the axe. Monster or not, Your Majesty, Count Smith of Lia's was a noble. We can't stand for a noble to be slain by some common-blooded mercenary. Arrest this man! Rip Count Smith of Lia's. Oh, boy. I can't even pay the dude. Huh. Man, I'm really getting fucked. Let the monster go, but pay him nothing. I fulfilled my side of the bargain. I'll be sure to tell everyone I meet that the king's word ain't worth the muck on my boots. Vogan spits on your feet and marches from the council hall without a backward glance. Yeah, that year sort of felt like I got totally screwed. I didn't really have any good options at all there. Luck is with us, my friend. The palace watch are in our pocket. They took our money gladly. The kingdom can barely afford to pay them a living wage, mostly because we forced that situation to occur. But, you know, whatever. What should the counts do now that they control the palace watch? Lower authority or raise their own military? Overwhelming support for option A. Not a big surprise. Kill the king and place their own claimant on the throne. Over the next few months, we'll have our troops infiltrate the capital disguised as beggars. At my signal, they'll gather and storm the palace in the dead of night. The bribed watch will open the gates, our soldiers will murder the king in his bed and have our claimant on the throne before sunrise. What about the chiefs and grandees? They'll call us usurpers and rise up in revolt. Not necessarily, my friend. If King Bear's rule is weak enough, we can persuade them to accept anything. They must lower the kingdom's authority to one or less. Chief One Happy Chipmunk is hosting yet another feast at his clan hall. Mead is being passed around in good measure, and some chiefs are dancing on the tables. Right, we've already seen the Ice Giant's progress here. So we'll see what their next step in the scheme is. Also with the option to pursue a lowered authority. Or lower stability once more. It's a little unfortunate that... Like, I can't blame y'all for choosing A again, but it's a little boring that the Chiefs went for literally the exact same plotline. Which makes you the enemy, I'm sorry to say. So, y'all, if we let the Chiefs win, we've all failed. Like, Chiefs are the bad guys now. Sorry to say, Chiefs. All right. Let's see here. Swing votes is always fun. I think I'll take that over anonymous voting. Reverse voting usually just leads to confusion, which is fun, but that one's more fun. All right, let's see. A laughing stock. Your Majesty, the acclaimed playwright Sylvester Natterflit has written another smash hit. All the theaters in the capital are showing it nightly. What's the problem? I've seen this one too, yeah. And an admiring homage, how delightful, yes. I'll attend the play myself. I mean, I know how to do this properly now, but I wonder if it'll play out differently. A shocked silence in the theater as heralds announce your arrival. What are you waiting for? Let the play begin. They somehow found an actor who looks just like you. Endless humiliations are heaped on this honking, squeaking parody. And the play concludes with the custard-drenched king handing his crown to the deserved hero. We climb onto the stage. We congratulate the actors on a hilarious play. We increase authority and stability. The whole capital can talk about nothing but your good humor and mercy. Look, I'll play to my advantages too if we're all going to be going about things the optimal way. Hail King Biffo, that's right. Your Highness, I'm ruined. Hordlings have occupied my vineyard and driven my staff away. What's a hordling? Grubby little creatures like fat green babies with claws. Hard to kill. Fire is the only way to get rid of them permanently. Whatever you do, we should do it soon. They're eating all of my grapes. Why can't your fellow grandees help out? My plight is of no interest to them. Well, assemble the council. What should be done about the hoarding infestation at Grandy Junbi's vineyard? Burn the vineyard with the hoardlings inside. Or strong arm the other grandees into sending military help. Huh. Feeling pretty confident there. That's looking like a call for unity, no doubt. As expected. Call for unity with two options. Yeah, that's... Alright, I can't complain too much. With that level of sway. Oh man, wow. Well done, I guess, possibly prohibiting the stability increase. Although I guess it is going to go through still, isn't it? Yeah, so be it. You tried. When the grandees grudgingly send in their token force, a slaughter ensues. The hordlings put up a meager fight before scurrying into the hills. Peculiarly, the grandees discovered that the hordlings filled Grandee Junbi's wine cellar with spoons. So many that it's almost impossible to move down there. We'll take some time before the vineyard is back up to full production, but Grandy Junebee is grateful for the help. Right. I do need some money myself, it turns out. The treasury is almost empty, Your Highness. Where the hell did it all go? Perhaps you've been spending a little too free. Oh, yeah, perhaps it's my fault. Apart from raising taxes, we have precious few options. You could get a bank loan or sell off the crown jewels. Perhaps crack open some of your predecessor's tombs. I gotta try this just out of curiosity. Oh, I don't know, though, actually. This one seems like it's pretty fitting here. Print money does sound like fun, though. The Royal Mint begins churning out new coins, allowing you to pay off several old debts. I am rich! Yay! Your heir. No way this could go poorly, right? Your quest for an heir is finally complete. You stand before the council holding a small child in your arms. Should I die, I ask that my crown be passed down to, let's go with my child, sure. The assembled nobles break out into polite applause. By designating an heir, you cemented the stability of the kingdom. Sure have. Thanks, Grandy. I know you're not feeling too great about it, but I appreciate you being able to put your ambitions aside in the celebration of life. Now you just need to fulfill your ambition to win the game. You know, just go ahead and just fulfill your ambition real quick. Just knock that out in a weekend. Your greatness, excellent news from beyond the sky. As your majesty knows, I'm an amateur astronomer. I've seen that a solar eclipse is on its way, visible from the north. We must encourage the kingdom to gather beneath the dark sun and experience this once-in-a-lifetime event. Ninth, preserve us, nay! An eclipse is a warning from the ninth god, a sign that the kingdom has fallen to shadow. All the nobles start talking at once. Some are excited, some are horrified, but all are very loud. How should the kingdom prepare for the eclipse? Focus on holy protection? Encourage visitors to the north to witness the event? These sun-obsessed fools should focus on their land, not the sky. Suppose I don't have a strong pull here. What would I most like to see pass? I mean, I wouldn't mind lower defiance. It's all about authority and stability at this point. Let's take away... I'd rather not call them sun-obsessed fools. I'm also weirdly concerned about the preservation of the state of this kingdom for a future run. And I'm thinking to myself, well, let's not allow the trade to get out of hand if that's the case. Let's let the farming get out of hand instead. Yeah, there we go. Much better. Although the Grandy's faith is getting up there too, I just realized. Could use some better farms. Yeah, I suppose so. Some of the chiefs grumble that the council isn't taking the impending solar event seriously. But even the grumpiest have to admit that concentrating on their terrestrial assets yields a decent bounty. Oh, you're right. Yeah, the seven was your starting faith, wasn't it? Troublesome holiday makers. That's my favorite John Candy movie. By the ninth, this is not to be borne. Grandy Gearlink brandishes a crumpled hat. A hat! Oh, gods bless you, I think that's mine. This was left on the edge of my estate by a group of chiefs on holiday, along with a huge number of empty bottles of mead. They scattered picnic baskets everywhere, trampled my crops, and sat around a bonfire all night. My horses were terrified. Now I know. The culprit was Chief Obly Pobly and his dissolute idle friends. We're just enjoying our prosperity and taking a break. Those clear skies, that shining sun. What a nice change from the north. You should be flattered that we're so eager to visit. Flattered. By the ninth. When the chiefs come to our lands, all they do is cause trouble and destruction. Should the chiefs continue their raucous holidays in the South? No more holidays in the South. The holidays can continue, but the chiefs must pay the grandees a generous sum. Carry on as usual. Grandee Gira Link is angry over nothing. Or encourage the chiefs to holiday in the East instead. I know it's going to piss off the grandees to do this, but I simply must. I just don't think I have a choice in the matter if I'm playing to win. Lekmoktra! Long-term resub. Bear hugs, please, for him. Thank you for the 76 months. Welcome back in. We encourage the chiefs to holiday in the East instead. Many chiefs accuse the East of being too wild and gloomy to have fun. The counts take this as a grave insult, getting into a heated argument. In the end, the chiefs do give in and visit for a few weeks. They arrange a few banquets, but soon head home complaining about the climate. Well, there you go, counts. Getting a little money, at least. I gotta say, this is easily the closest I've ever felt to a victory. I'm beginning to have hope. Auction time. If only I could contribute. The Treasury would like to have a word here. Chiefs can either increase farming or decrease military. Counts choose between decreasing farming or decreasing authority. Grandees have increased faith or decreased stability. And again, I should stop phrasing it like that because you're free to contribute to any building regardless of your affiliation. You can also contribute multiple times, so long as you have the funds available. Yeah, that can happen, unfortunately, sometimes, Nero. The buildings just aren't in your favor for your pursuits, but, I mean, you do, at least as a grandee, you've got the prison here that's getting closer to your goal. Albeit still pretty far away. There goes authority and stability, unsurprisingly. The theater and the prison will be constructed. Ooh, my ambition. At the start of your reign, you said you wanted to be a peacekeeper. You've succeeded on that front. The kingdom is peaceful, and you're renowned for your mercy and wisdom. Well done, Your Majesty. But to shut down your noble scheming for good, we need to build on that reputation. Your advisors have some ideas. The common folk are a sleeping giant that even the nobles are afraid to wake. If you become beloved by the peasants... You guys say beloved or beloved? I go back and forth on that word all the time. The nobles won't dare overthrow you for fear of revolution. My advice, on the other hand, would be to infiltrate each region with loyal spies. Defeat their schemes with schemes of our own. But the Chancellor has other ideas. Depends on how fancy I'm trying to be. Yeah, that sounds about right. Stability in trade or stability in farming? Definitely create a kingdom-wide spy network. A wise decision, Your Majesty. I'll begin recruiting spies. We'll send them across the kingdom in the guise of traveling bards. But this will require a fine touch. Your priority is to raise the kingdom's stability and overall trade as much as you can. And of course, there can't be open rebellion among the nobles. Yeah, this is the furthest I've gotten for sure. That's exciting. I got to step two for once. A magical request. A wizard calling himself Scrampton keeps sending these dreadful letters. They smell of rotting fish and dissolve into seawater as soon as they're read. He demands access to the north on the day of the eclipse. He'll use the power of the darkened sun for some special magic. But wizards are trouble. Should a wizard be allowed to use the power of the solar eclipse? Pay the chiefs to host Scrampton. Let Scrampton do whatever he wants. Force him to pay for the privilege of using the eclipse's power. when it seems this clear, I feel I ought to go ahead and do it. Let's see if I get another honk for you too. Nope, not that time. See, that's the risk I run with the honk. The chance of what one might kindly call an unpleasant sound. Oh, I think I missed my call for unity. Just by a hair there. You send a stern letter to Scrampton demanding he pay his dues. You hear nothing. The chiefs hear nothing. Some peasants report the faint crash of waves at the end of their hearing, but that couldn't be related, could it? Meanwhile, the eclipse approaches. Uh-oh. Your Holiness, the Hordlings, they've returned! The soldiers we sent only got rid of them temporarily. They've taken over my vineyard again! Those little bastards are impossible to kill. Never mind that. Your Highness must act quickly to alleviate the spoon shortage in the south. Spoons are disappearing all across the region. I'm sorry, spoons? It's no laughing matter. Have you ever tried to eat soup with a fork? It's simply impossible. You've got to be joking. Grandees. This is why you don't get to win, Grandees. Final call vote. What can be done about the missing spoons in the south and the hordling attack on Junbi's vineyard? Pivot the south's industries to make more spoons. Burn down Grandy Junbi's vineyard to destroy the hordlings. Order a hunt for the missing spoons. Do nothing. These are trivial matters. Swing vote. Hit it. Go crazy. Well, sorry, Junbi. Seems you've made a few enemies, including among your fellow Grandies. Chill's had enough of your shit. Burn down Grandy Junbi's vineyard to destroy the hordlings. That's your boyfriend's character. That's hilarious, Joe. No, that's not what I was asking for. That vineyard is my livelihood. But an infestation of hordlings is no single person's problem. If they were to spread, they could ruin more and more homes and businesses across the south. The vineyard and half the hillside with it is lit up like the sun. Once Grandy Junbi's wealth goes up in smoke, it's not long before she's turned to begging on the streets of Calebra. Most peculiarly, you find a hoard of missing spoons in the burning wreckage. Seems the hordlings were collecting them. How odd! Everybody gets some money! No, that's a terrible idea. Let's see here. Clearly I don't have enough. That's the takeaway. Yeah, I need some more cash. Let's do that. Let's definitely be cruel here. And, you know, I think they can handle it. I don't know if I ever don't do that. All goes according to plan, Your Majesty. Let me show you. Your spymaster takes you through a secret passage in your own private office. You emerge into a hidden chamber where a number of hooded figures are waiting. These are my agents. They can blend into a crowd as effortlessly as they can slip a knife between a traitor's ribs. Why didn't I know about this chamber? Don't worry about it. The palace is riddled with secret passages and hidden rooms. I'll keep track of them for you. Yeah, I feel like I ought to worry about that. Soon our spies will infiltrate the courts of all the nobles on your council, disguised as traveling bards. One of the spies tosses aside her cloak, revealing a lute in the colorful costume of a troubadour. With charm and flattery, they'll worm their way into your nobles' hearts and minds. Then we'll have a spy network, the likes of which the world has never seen. I hope to make even the Gaunt of T'Valin look like rank amateurs. This should put a stop to their foolish schemes. And we'll keep the kingdom stable for the rest of your reign. A little blackmail is a small price to pay. A week passes before you hear more news. Your spymaster arrives in your office with a tiny scroll small as the cherry stem, clutched between two fingertips. This is a message from one of our agents in the field, Your Majesty. I sent her to Grandy Platypus Bilduck's manor disguised as a caroler, armed with a lute and a book of hymns. But why are they in a field? Figure of speech, Your Majesty. Let's open this up. Wait to hear the success of your fledgling spy. The spymaster studies the scroll for a moment, then sighs and holds it over a candle flame. It vanishes in a puff of cinders. She was turned away at the gates. There's no money for entertainers at the moment, and little reason to celebrate with song and dance. I suspect it's the same story all over the kingdom. We'll try again in a few months! God damn it! Oh, decrease in difficulty with each failed attempt. Okay. Hyperinflation. I wonder what that could be related to. Behold, Your Highness. Count Jackson pulls aside a tarpaulin to reveal a granite statue of Count Galau. Galua. The statue is impeccably detailed, its expression a frozen grimace. A sad sight, is it not? The sculptor is most talented. No, Your Highness, this is no statue. It seems the Stone Maiden is abroad in the east. Well, I know she's abroad. She's called the Stone... Oh, groan! Boo! Who's that? She's a walking statue with burning yellow eyes. All who meet her gaze are turned to stone. She sleeps for years at a time before walking or waking and terrorizing the kingdom. She must have ambushed Count Galua on her latest walk in the cemetery. Please, Your Grace, we must do something. You're just straight up dead. What can be done to stop the Stone Maiden before she petrifies someone else? I got the money. I'll try that out again. I'll take care of this. Throws money at the problem. Tell everyone in the east to hide is a great option. Absent anything else. Like, regardless of the circumstances. I almost want to do that just to see what happens, and it sounds like I'm not alone. Ooh, is it a call for unity even? Oh, it's so close. It's so close. Call for unity! To arms! Straggling voters! Your king decrees! Vote for C's! Is that it? That's it! He's done it! Hooray for math! That's not a solution! That's pure cowardice! The counts refuse to hide in their houses like cowards. They continue business as usual. The Stone Maiden, enraged, stalks the east for weeks on end, turning thousands of peasants into twisted granite figurines. Farming is now barren. At long last, she retreats to her lair deep underground and falls asleep once more. On the bright side, the counts now have plenty of oddly realistic statues to sell. Hey, all right. Worth it. As you ordered, Your Majesty, the Royal Mint has churned out thousands of new coins using cheap gold-like metals. The treasury is technically replenished. My genius is almost frightening. But it's also devaluing the currency across the kingdom. A loaf of bread now costs 100 times what it used to. Something must be done. If this gets worse, our currency will be worthless. Oh no, my ambition. Ah, fuck. There's nothing wrong with this. Let it continue. Adopt an entirely new currency and declare the old one illegitimate. Or adopt a foreign currency instead. Oh no. Well, I certainly don't want to do that. I don't know about either of these, but better than the third, I guess. There's nothing wrong with this. Let it continue. Or adopt an entirely new currency and declare the old one illegitimate. I'm sure that'll go over well. There it is. Predictably enough, absolutely everyone from the lowest peasant to the highest noble is outraged to find their money is suddenly worthless. The resulting chaos makes buybacks difficult and fraud is rampant. Riots consume every major city. This is fine. The South swells with a sudden influx of devotees from across the kingdom. They've come to see the Ninth Herald Zenaviva in action. In the picturesque town of Serena, the Grandee's holy claimant delivers a speech to raucous applause. Two figures stand in an alcove nearby. If our army were strong enough, we could take the palace by force. A crusade? That sounds promising. Though I suggest we leave it up to the Ninth God. Surely he will intervene on Zenaviva's behalf. How should the Grandees put Zenaviva, the Ninth Herald, on the throne? Raise their military or raise their faith? Grandees out of nowhere with the steel chair. You love to see it, dude. What a swing. Yeah, not a surprise. Overwhelming support to raise their faith. Let us join in prayer, fellow Grandees. The end of King Baer's illegitimate, godless rule is upon us. Our claimant Zenaviva is poised to take the throne and usher in a new golden age. We need only wait for a miracle. For the final stage, the Grandees must raise their faith to at least 9. Ooh, boy. All right. I need to get that stability up still. I'll go with the Monarch's Golden Choice. That certainly seems like a valuable one given the fact that I'm pretty sure I just made everybody flat fucking broke. Yeah. Methinks you might need some personal wealth. Oh boy. Revenge of a Wizard. In the capital, the solar eclipse does little except make the day a little gray. But the north is a different story. Your Majesty, grave reports. When the sun went dark, Scrampton stepped out of the air and stood with arms outstretched. He was engulfed in a tornado of salt water, but just stood there and laughed. Eventually, the water vanished, but more shells and coral erupted from his flesh. Then, with his new power, he sent a briny flood across the land. Our farms are submerged. This is all the king's fault. We need to fix this, and fast. Huh. Conscript peasants as apprentices for Scrampton. Oh my goodness. That does sound funny, yeah. It is nice to be able to get a call for unity split between two choices. That feels a little unfair, but again, I gotta take every advantage I can get, I think. Wizard fight! The spymaster starts spreading rumors that the plague wizard known as Pestia wants to battle. Scranton sees through the ruse immediately and responds by digging in his heels, bleeding the land dry before disappearing in an instant. In his wake, the peasants discover more and more unnerving phenomena. A turnip with a toothed maw that screams when dug up. A tree that oozes with blood beneath the noonday sun. Fish that turn to ash when caught. The Archbishop scrambles to contain widespread fear that the Ninth God has forsaken the North. I mean, it seems like the truth, to be honest with you. Oh, famine, huh? That sounds good. Hello, Your Majesty. I've traveled all the way from the east to beg you to do something about the price of grain. I can't afford to feed my family. A day of back-breaking work isn't enough to buy a day's worth of bread. She's right. The grain price in the east is beyond all control. Greedy merchants rake in profit while the common folks starve. What should be done about the rising price of grain in the East? Oh my god. I don't know if I can even help myself in this case. I suppose I want to... I don't know, man. Fuck it. Yeah, things aren't going well. It's looking pretty bad. I'm worried that we're yet again going to leave the kingdom in an irredeemable state. But we'll see, I guess. Yeah, I'm not too shocked to see here the chiefs opting for the authority check. I was willing to give it a roll, I guess. You place a strict price cap on grain. However, wily merchants start using the grain to brew alcohol to avoid losing money and get around your orders. As a result, the supply of grain goes from hardly any to almost none. The peasants are worse off than ever, and starvation grips the East. Cool. Baer, my novelty spoon has gone missing again. Come to think of it, lots of our spoons have been disappearing recently. I've noticed that too. Clearly some fool's idea of a prank. We need to find them and get my spoon back while we're at it. Search the castle. Someone must be responsible. You search up and down, but find nothing. Spoons continue to go missing. Okay. You forbid the cook from preparing liquid meals, lest you seen slurping from the bowl. Right, because spoons would be the fucking thing. Good lord. A rude awakening. Yeah, good, cool. Baer, no, you sabotaged yourself. No, I don't choose to believe that's the case. At first, it's a night like any other. After a pleasant evening by the fire with your husband, you retreat to bed. Your sleep is dreamless, a sweet oblivion. Baer, wake up, I hear something. It's well past midnight. When your husband wakes you, you hear a scuffle somewhere on the lower floors of the palace, soon shouting, quickly silence. How dare they interrupt our sleep like this? Go back to sleep, dear. You're having a nightmare. As your head touches the pillow, one of your northern warriors bursts into your bedchamber, a deep gash across his chest. His grip trembles on his blood-soaked axe. Treachery! Eastern troops are storming the palace. The palace watch let them in. Before the warrior can utter another word, a knight in eastern armor kicks back open the door and shoves a sword into his back. A figure you recognize follows the knight into the room. It's Countess Chotokana. Sorry to disturb your sleep, Your Grace, but don't worry. I'm being a cheeky little shit. Fuck you, Your Honor. Your Grace. Your King. Suck a fucking big fat one. You suck. Should've passed that 60% check, idiot. Should've rolled the dice better when you had a 60% chance to win the game, Baer, you stupid fucking moron. Way to go, dumbass. Unsurprisingly, King Baer didn't survive his impact with the cobblestones, but the street was renamed in his honor, Pancake Lane. That's hilarious. After killing the king, the counts also made sure to butcher all his supporters. Weeks into Queen Louise's reign, servants were still trying to get the stains out of the palace carpets. The common folk whispered that a reign born in blood would also end in it. Yeah, no, I'm not salty at all. Not a tiny little bit. Nope. All right, cool. Fun. Baer, let's run it back. Okay, fine. Fuck me. Let's do it. Let me go refill my coffee. I'll be right back. All right. Chiefs, I swear to God, if you guys go Ice Giants again, I'm gonna permanently remove you from the game. I'm gonna send a request to the developers that the Chiefs of the North be exiled permanently. But Ice Giants. I know they're fun, but there's other options, all right? Let's branch out a little bit. We'll just ban them all. Yeah, there we go. All right, so I am going to jump through the first stuff pretty quickly since we've seen these a few times now. The only options I believe I have yet to pursue are as Mother of the Nation for farming or as a saint for the faith. And it sounds fun to pursue faith. That's unusual. It's going to be difficult, I assume, considering our current circumstances. Military would be easier, certainly. I feel like it might actually... I'm out of curiosity. Well, I should pick an easy one. Yeah, I know, you're probably right. I was going to say, out of curiosity, I wanted to do some science to see whether or not they would set the parameter based on where we're currently at with the stats, but I assume it's probably not going to do that. A warrior queen is sure to be remembered fondly if she wins more battles than she loses. All right, there we go. Let's get our coronation out of the way here. What kind of coronation should be held for the new queen? We can't even do the dignitaries this time. Ooh, I actually have a degree of control over it. The nobles must put on a vast banquet for the queen. Yeah! That's what I want. That's what I want, man. Give me that one. You guys mind floating the bill for once? It gives you farming. You like farms, you like eating, don't you? I know the counts would probably be interested in that. I feel like their famine might have a small influence on this vote. But Bear, what if we threw the queen into the river instead? Oh, no, you've chosen instead to make the correct choice. And put on a vast banquet for the queen. The nobles spare no expense, and your banquet table groans under the weight of it all. Whole roasted peacock, a boar's head stuffed with swan's tongues, an entire whale turning on a spit. How? I'm just confused, mostly. You really spared no expense. There's all your money. Or suppose your lack thereof. Holy hell! Y'all broke. Events have proceeded exactly according to plan. The throne is ours. Now just remember our agreement. In all matters of state, you shall favor the East. What if I govern for the good of the whole kingdom? Please, put these delusions of benevolence out of your head. It's embarrassing. We put that crown on your head. Don't make us take it away. Now introduce yourself to the rest of the council, but don't forget what I told you today. That inflation really did a number on us. I'm not sure. I don't know what you're talking about. Couldn't have had anything to do with that. Good luck in the days ahead, Your Majesty, says Chief Lizzo. You'll need it, dealing with us a lot. Grandy Nanit one. May the ninth god bless your reign, Your Highness. Also, rabble, if you don't mind. What do you think? Will she be a good little queen and do as she's told? Too early to tell. But I have a bad feeling. We should have a backup plan, just in case. Let's find out what that's going to be. Mara of the No-Hit-Kill Dynasty, sinister eastern bird breeder, leans delicately on a podium, speaking in a melodious voice. My fellow counts, we put Queen Louisa on the throne. It seems she's forgotten that already. Don't you think I'd make a better ruler? That wasn't a very convincing argument. Blood ritual. In pursuit of the highest farming? Ascension, looking to lower their own faith, or possession, looking to lower their own defiance? This particular vote open only to counts of the East. How can you tell if you've joined? I could do this for you to show you that, yes, indeed, you specifically have joined. I don't know if there's a way for you guys to check, though, without me doing that. Yeah, another repeat, unfortunately. It is difficult to, like, expect people to vote otherwise, right? Oh, the extension shows you. Yeah, there you go. Nice. That's convenient. Yeah, it's like, when you already have basically met the goal, it's pretty difficult not to choose it, right? The counts plan to induct the queen into their secret cult and offer her immortality in exchange for the throne. Yep, we've seen that one. Four or less faith. Not going to be too tough. No, it just puts you in a group randomly, Lizzo. Unless you played in the previous game, in which case it will put you back in the same group. Orm of the Naki Cappuccino clan. Sinister northern god speaker stands precariously on a longhouse crossbeam, screaming like a fallen god. Chiefs of the North, we all know I should be on the throne, not this imposter Queen Louisa. How do we make that happen? Swear to God, chiefs. Didn't even give you the option. Finally, oh my goodness. Praise be the benevolence of the game. We're looking to lower defiance, raise authority, or lower all faith. Those sound like fun. I think we might have seen prophecy for them as well, though. No. I'm pretty sure both times for the Chiefs, it's been Ice Giants. Maybe even all three. We've had them for... This is their fourth time now, right, I think? At any rate. It shall be the prophecy. The Chiefs plan to realize an ancient northern prophecy. Before the new monarch rises, the kingdom will be ruled by a mad tyrant. To advance their scheme, the chiefs must raise authority to five or more in two seasons. We have to choose three of the five, Lizzo, so we've just been switching between them. We played with the barons before. Chris of the Junbi lineage, powerful former priest, stands bathed in sunshine, speaking softly. A false pretender occupies the throne while my claim is ignored. Grandees, this is a stain on our honor. We must not allow it to go unanswered. Shall the grandees lower stability, raise their own farming, or lower stability, but, you know, in a different way? Between subterfuge and excommunication, I think I probably would choose excommunication. Subterfuge just seems like it's got too many other possible definitions. The Grandy Claimant Chris has been chosen by the Ninth God to be the next monarch. They promised a first miracle, food for all. The Grandies must raise their farming to five or more. So all three regions have already met their goal here. Again, the Chiefs looking for at least two authority, or sorry, at least five authority. Two would be ridiculous. The Counts looking to keep their faith below four, or four or less. Chris, the questionable claimant of the Grandees, and to raise their farming to five or more. Yeah, everybody pretty much just skipped the first step, which is not uncommon, actually. I think I need to get my veto back. I actually don't want Monarch's Iron Choice right now. Oh, wait, no, I have my veto, right. I'll take Royal Gamble. Yeah, that's definitely the way to go. All right. Disquiet in the South. Your Highness, my peasants accuse me of hoarding wealth. Is that even possible? Do you have any wealth to hoard? I mean, of all of the grandees, I suppose you are one that has some. Worse, they're throwing down their tools and burning their belongings, saying they want to live an ascetic life and I should do the same. They want to have more exercise? No, not athletic, ascetic. They don't want to be pinned down by worldly possessions, but burning them is quite the overreaction. The ringleader of this movement is a philosopher called Ortega. She calls herself a voice for the ninth god, and the peasants hang on her every word. They'll be at my door any moment. How should Ortega and her anti-wealth followers be dealt with? Let's see. Aggressively break up Ortega's meetings. That sounds like it could be fun. Royal gamble is exactly that. It's a gamble. I think I'd rather do this for now. I think I didn't make that play when I'm feeling real certain. When there's gonna be situations that arise where y'all just basically don't have a choice. I didn't necessarily feel like this was the case here. I think y'all would have been privy to send someone to infiltrate the cult, in fact, should I have chosen that. The counts welcome the extra cash for the use of their peasants. The fines can't go any lower. That's not surprising, I guess. Meanwhile, more and more southern servants discard their possessions to follow Ortega's teachings. One evening, you're sitting up in bed reading some paperwork when a filth-encrusted peasant wanders into your bedchamber as bold as brass.
Hiya, Maj. Glad I finally found you. This bloody place is a maze. Mind if I take a seat?
Who are you?
Me name's Ralph, Maj. Pleased to meet you. Listen, I got a bloody great idea for you. What if we tied a bunch of birds to a knight? I reckon you could field some aerial troops and totally dominate the battlefield.
Before Ralph could explain further, your marshal bursts into the bedchamber, sword drawn.
Your Majesty, I'm sorry I didn't come sooner. I have no idea where the palace watch are.
Do you want me to kill this intruder?
No, I want to hold a vote on his proposal.
Oh, thank God they're actually allowing me to do it.
She goes and gathers up your council, who trickle into the hall in their pajamas, rubbing sleep from their eyes. They don't look particularly pleased to be woken up.
Should we experiment with tying birds to knights for the purpose of aerial combat?
Abso-fucking-lutely.
Yes. And the pilot program will be with the Counts of the East.
Yes.
Yes. Begin.
Put it on the Counts.
It's their job. And I feel confident in a call to action to the other two regions to combine with the third. However, the third one seems to be more adamant about it.
Boo, by the way. Boo. Boo.
Boo, you stink!
Team no fun down here. Wow. The pilot program shall be in the east. Under Ralph's close supervision, I'm glad he's involved, a flock of ravens are tied to an eastern knight. Instead of flying, the knight is lost in a flurry of mad pecking and pooping. Ralph insists you merely use the wrong type of bird. Further experiments are conducted with owls, eagles, geese, woodpeckers, ostriches, and little grebs before hundreds of eastern troops quit in disgust. Needless to say, the whole thing is an embarrassing failure.
Well, that's convenient.
Your Majesty, if that peasant hadn't been a maniac with a crossbow, I dread to think what could have happened. He probably would have had a better idea for the military. If one thing's clear from this mess, it's that you need an honor guard who can actually keep you safe, not like the pathetic watch. Think carefully, Your Majesty. These guards' loyalties will be divided between you and their region.
Ooh, look at time spiral here.
The Queen knows better than anyone that our knights will keep her safe from danger and improper grammar. Nah, I'm gonna go with the battle nuns again. Well, actually, if I take the Northern Warriors here, they do have the highest military. Could maybe use that to my advantage. That makes sense. Blood and stars, Your Grace. How could you choose them? We'll make the arrangements at once. There we go. And an invitation. Without a word, Count Flying Enemy hands you a blood-red envelope. It's sealed with white wax in the shape of a skull. Inside is a beautifully written invitation to an event called the Crimson Vigil, due to take place on an autumn night later in the year. What is this all about? I can say no more. You must choose whether to accept our invitation or decline it. And I suppose I'll go. I'll see you next at the Vigil, Your Majesty. All right. Auction time. Either increase stability or authority with a library and monument. I gotta stop saying either. Library will increase stability. Monument will increase authority. Grand Bazaar will increase trade. Observatory will decrease faith. Aqueduct will increase farming. Stadium will decrease military. I have no money. Should have thought of that before you reset the entire economy. You fool. Well, some of you got some pittance down here, right? Who reset it again? You know, the history books are still debating. Ultimately, I think it's just a matter of opinion. No one can really truly know. Exclamation point fund, followed by the letter corresponding to the building, followed by the amount you'd like to contribute. You can indeed contribute multiple times to multiple buildings. I am also pretty sure, I don't know if I've seen anybody even try. Can you only fund it in certain increments? Did everyone just collectively decide to agree to fund it in increments of 5? It's like, that's what's happened, right? At like, 100% of us have all agreed not to fuck around with any weird numbers. Literally everyone is contributing numbers that end in 5 or 0 just because it feels right. That's hilarious. Right, anyway. Time to find a spouse. Your Majesty, it's important you find a spouse. Well, go get one then, damn it. The cult spreads. There's a problem with the followers of that southerner, Ortega. Her teachings have spread to the east. Not the east, that's where they like things the most. Worse, she's getting stronger. She's performing miracles, healing a woman's broken arm with a single touch, curing an old man's blindness. Okay, so now you're going to tell me how we should stop her? All over the east, the serfs are throwing away their goods and cursing the counts for their greed. They're clashing with priests, even starting brawls in the streets. Every day, we lose more workers to this cult. How can it be contained, this motherfucker? Have Ortega assassinated? Oh my god. No thanks. No thank you. I know the chiefs would love that. Fucking monsters. Although it's looking, unfortunately, like they're gonna be able to give us an authority check anyway. All right. After a week, the Archbishop reluctantly issues a proclamation stating that Ortega and her cult is a legitimate branch of the Church of the Ninth God. Her followers are delighted. Wow. All right. fucking take that, dude. That was a good outcome. The Crimson Vigil takes place in a bleak castle atop an eastern hill. Your journey takes weeks, and your baggage train keeps getting stuck in bogs. Guests at the Crimson Vigil compete on who can dress in the most ghoulish and frightening costume. What did you dress as? Just your normal clothes. You have no wish to partake in this nonsense. When Count Flying Enemy sweeps in, dressed as a living corpse, he looks disappointed by your lack of costume. Yeah, now I feel bad. Now I feel like a party pooper. No costume, Your Majesty. Well, no one even told me! You showed up to the damn court and you gave me a piece of paper and you said, I expect to see you there. What do you think I know your standard, your custom? I suppose I should, being the king of the land and one who is attempting to earn the respect of his nobles and peasants alike, but I don't know. Next time I'll be a dragon. Please remember to stay in the upper levels. The dungeons are out of bounds. In the ballroom, I am also a count, right? I forgot. In the ballroom, you find the counts gathered, all dressed up as frightful monsters. Wolfmen, pumpkin heads, witches. A waiter glides past, holding a tray of Zenfuros. Sorry, I'm not sure why he called them sandwiches. I don't know what the hell that is. A pianist plays a mournful tune. The Crimson Vigil begins at midnight. What role will you take? A mourner? Or are you willing to portray a Hound of the Betrayer? I'm not even going to ask, dude. I'll be a Hound of the Betrayer. The counts gather. After Count Flying Enemy delivers a short speech about remembering the old ways, a flaming crown is placed upon his head. I will be playing the Queen in Exile this evening. The Hounds of the Betrayer will try to catch me, but fear not. I am swift as a falling star and old as the hills. I feel like that second one isn't as helpful. Flying Enemy runs down the corridor, flames licking behind him, and you give chase. A dozen other Hounds of the Betrayer run alongside you, howling and yipping enthusiastically. Somehow, despite the silly costume and massive flaming hat, Flying Enemy is quick on his feet. Catching him won't be easy. I gotta chase after him, of course. As you plunge deeper and deeper into the castle, you hear ominous chanting close by. Too late. You remember Flying Enemy's warning that the dungeons are forbidden. Uh-oh. Press onward. You burst into a star-shaped chamber. Hooded figures are standing around a twisted idol, blood-soaked knives in their hands. You recognize some of the counts who were missing from upstairs. They pause their chanting. At the foot of the idol is an altar upon which lies some half-human, half-goat, writhing in pain or ecstasy. You never should have come here. It's not helping to sell the seriousness of the situation, Count Bill Rye, the Jewish guy. Wordlessly join in. You join the chant, walking circles around the writhing thing on the altar. The counts, after a moment's confusion, accept your presence and allow you to take part in their secret ritual. At the ritual's climax, the writhing thing is killed. You all drink its blood and share a vision of a man being meticulously torn into pieces, of a woman drowning in infinite darkness, of a monster sitting on a throne of embers. 1,000 feet tall, wider than a castle, it sits wearing a crown of flames, with serpents writhing under its skin, and it plots against the god who cast it down. You slip into a fitful, fevered sleep, and then you wake up alone in your chambers. Did any of that really happen? As the night passes, you hear cheerful music from the ballroom, then even laughter and raucous singing. What did you miss? Regardless, you board your carriage at dawn and begin the long journey back to the capital. Yeah, I'm not gonna lie. I'm keeping a little bit of my spite against the chiefs preserved. Although it is the only one that I've felt is, you know, one I'm capable of preventing in this moment. All the same. Chiefs didn't even win last round. Still, they know what they did. Far to the north, where snows blanket the landscape and wolves howl in the night, the chiefs uncover an ancient prophecy foretelling the rise of the tyrant queen. This isn't what the prophecy says would happen. Right, wasn't there supposed to be a tyrant queen? Something about drowning the kingdom in blood? Ah, keep your hat on. We're not there yet, but she needs a bit of encouragement, that's all. A few more executions, unjust imprisonments, that sort of thing. Then the prophecy will be fulfilled, and Orm will rise! The chief's aim is to raise authority to at least 5. And all she did was drink blood. That's just a typical Saturday afternoon for most of these peasants. There we go. That'll work. Thank you. Your Majesty, some anonymous firebrand in the south is spreading most inflammatory pamphlets. They're casting aspersions against you. What's new? Something's different this time. They're not just calling you a bad queen, they're criticizing the very concept of monarchy. Not republicanism again. God damn it. How should the council respond to these dangerous republican pamphlets? Well, I'm looking to raise my military. Sadly, there's no option to do that here. I am quite concerned about our current level of authority. I think I'd like to get a little influence toward B. I'm wondering, though. I think maybe I ought to veto C instead. Yeah, that sounds right. Well, the counts know, or sorry, not the counts, the chiefs know what to do. Their best option, pretty straightforward here. Yeah, let's just murder everybody. That's a good call, chiefs. This is just a small example of what would happen should they be given power for even a moment. Your grim orders are followed by watchmen across the south. Common folk are searched at random and hanged on the spot if a pamphlet is found on their person. Soon enough, you can't travel anywhere in the south without seeing a corpse dangling from a tree or signpost. By the ninth, Your Majesty, I know we have to kill some peasants now and then, but this is too far. Despite the carnage, the pamphlets explode in popularity. Your tyranny has only served to prove them right. I've found 3 potential matches for you. Let's take a peek. This is Niall, firstborn son of the Northern Eves clan. He's your typical northern lad, as far as I can tell. Big and loud and all the social graces of a goat, but means well. Even among the northerners, he's made something of a name for himself as a fierce warrior. People say he nurses a grudge, though. This is Lorelei, the eldest daughter of the Eastern Lost Gerbil Dynasty. Apparently, they had a hell of a time getting her to smile for the portrait. She had a laboratory installed in her castle and spends most of her time there conducting bizarre experiments. She went missing a while ago, but it turned out she'd accidentally locked herself in the cellar. Survived on wine for a week. Intriguing. And finally, Balthazar, the eldest son of the Theranium Dragoon lineage. I don't even need to read anything else about him. Obviously, I'm picking him. His name is fucking Balthazar of the Theranium Dragoon lineage. Why did the others even bother showing up? There we go. Well, I guess their portraits were the ones that showed up. Your Majesty, about that troublesome philosopher Ortega. I must protest you allowing her teachings to run unchecked. And her miracles are unorthodox at best. How can we allow that is what is effectively witchcraft to flourish in our ranks? Not to mention the fact that she keeps complaining about supposed church riches and saying we should give them away. Are you worried about her teachings or your reputation? I must express my displeasure with the utmost urgency. We wouldn't want the High Inquisitor to get involved. Don't extort me. You must make Ortega welcome. The Archbishop storms out in a huff. Later, he conducts a public ceremony to formally bless Ortega and her followers. Oh, she's gonna take over, dude. He just about keeps it together for the ceremony, and Ortega is impeccably polite. Her followers praise the queen for her open mind. That's a lot of faith. Fanatical in the South. That seems a little concerning. In a tiny village far to the east, two counts meet in a derelict tavern. No one dares even glance in their direction. Another priest left my estate today. He said there was no sense of preaching to the truly lost. I've heard the same across the east. We're no longer trapped under the church's thumb. Now we must not falter. If the queen grows proud, we can offer her the ultimate reward. Immortality. For the next stage of their scheme, the counts must raise authority to 5 or more in 4 seasons. Well, makes my job easy. Let's see. Call for unity returns. That could be worth it. Yeah, I'll grab that. An untimely death. Murder! My father, Chief Eurozilis, has been murdered. And I know who did it. It was Grandy Picklebrine, by Odeld's horn. Don't let him deny it. I won't deny that I killed the venerable Chief Eurozilis. It was a duel, which I won. We've seen this before. What is the council's response to accusations that Picklebrine is a murderer? I think we let y'all decide this one fairly. For once, we allow proper democracy to dictate the outcome. Man, I might have wanted to go for a call for unity here. I should have expected that, actually. I'm not surprised by this at all. That's how I would have voted. You would let a murderer walk loose, even after he admitted it right in this council chamber. Mother of mountains! I'm glad the council respects the duelist code. Once agreed upon, a duel cannot be rescinded. Well, rip Picklebrine in a couple of seasons. Upcoming vengeance tour. Let's go to the famine first. Your Majesty, I've traveled all the way from the east to beg you to do something about the price of grain. I can't afford to feed my family. A day of backbreaking work isn't enough. All right, Bree, what do we do? It should be done about the rising price of grain in the east. Put a cap on the price, subsidize grain, and ensure it's sold for half its worth. Import grain from the south and distribute it for free. The free market will correct itself in time. I'm not gonna say anything else, I'm just gonna look at you. Yeah, that's fair. That makes sense. Import grain from the south and distribute it for free. The east is in your debt, your majesty. The kingdom's coffers open and a tide of free grain floods from the south to the east, putting many eastern merchants out of business but giving some grandees a nice windfall. Some grandees' wealth has increased. The grain proves sufficient to keep the peasants alive until the next harvest, which will hopefully bring better days. No longer a famine in the east, thank goodness. All right. Your wedding to Balthazar is naturally the talk of the kingdom. Nobles and peasants alike travel from across the realm to attend. For a week and a day, the capital is one giant party. Do you take this man as your lawfully wedded husband?
I've changed my mind! I can't do this! You flee from the cathedral, leaving the guests and the archbishop in stunned silence. I've never been so insulted in all my life!
Balthazar storms off in a fury, leaving the archbishop alone at the altar. All right, everybody, looks like the wedding's off. Let me take this opportunity to deliver a sermon. You run until the muttering of the crowd is lost to the winds. Looking around, you find yourself in the palace gardens. Sitting on a bench, you try to compose yourself. When you look up, you see the chancellor watching you sympathetically. Never mind, Your Majesty. The scandal will die down, eventually. What do you plan to do now? I will marry my true love, a low-born commoner. I want to live a life of chastity in honor of the ninth god. Marriage would suffocate me. I plan to enjoy my reign. Nah, let's marry a commoner. Oh, how romantic. The nobles will hate you for it, unfortunately. Good luck in the days ahead. You'll need it. Hell yeah. The prophesied Ninth's Herald has finally manifested on Celestath, taking the form of a humble noble known as Chris, who hails from a farming town on the southern hills, or so the grandees claim. Peasants all over the south are flocking to you, Chris. I knew you could do it. The plentiful crops have been a significant boon to our economy. This is just the beginning. With him on our side, we will capture the minds of the common folk and lead a holy crusade. They must lower stability to 4 or less in 2 seasons. All right, then. All about authority and stability again. On the verge of rebellion. Ah, secret romance. It's near impossible to sneak out of the palace at night. The palace watch keeps catching you and dragging you back to your bedroom. But tonight you've managed it. Bundled up in a dark cloak and hood, you head out to the capital's market district. Your true love is waiting for you on a bridge. Your love's name, of course, is... Jay. They rush into your arms and press their mouth to yours. It's a while before anything needs to be said aloud. My love, it's been months since we last saw each other like this. I'm sorry. Don't worry, every second I get to spend with you is worth a year of waiting. But why did it take you so long? Palace Watch realized I was sneaking out. It must be such a hardship to be the ruler of the entire kingdom, Your Majesty. They can't get through those last 2 words without breaking into laughter. What happened to the brash young princess who snuck out of the palace so she could see the real world? That was when you met the love of your life, in case you forgot. We were so young. We still are. You just need to relax. That crown's as heavy as a whole kingdom. You should take it off once in a while. Why don't we head back to your place? You and Jay return to their cottage and spend the night together. As usual, you must sneak back to the palace before dawn, but before you leave, they catch your arm. I'm tired of waiting, my love. I can't live like this. We need to get married in the eyes of the ninth god for all to see. Yeah, let's do it. Thank you, my love. Oh, this is so exciting. I can't wait. You put up your hood and sneak back to the palace. Oh, shit. That's hilarious that the chiefs of the north have overwhelmingly voted to rebel. Your Majesty, a shipwreck has appeared on the edge of my estate. It's not even from the north. Its name is the Serafina, and it bears a southern flag. That vessel went missing a few months back. We feared she was lost at sea. Well, she's been found on land, right on top of my favorite picnic spot. My common folk discovered only one survivor on board, a southern sailor. He claims to remember nothing of what happened. My head's killing me. It has been ever since I woke up. What happened to you? I swear I didn't do anything. Last I remember, we were sailing along southern waters and then nothing. This poor soul needs looking after. We must care for him in one of our monasteries. Nay, we must interrogate him further. I must know why this ship is on my land. What should be done with the stranded southern sailor and his mysterious shipwreck? So I'm attempting to increase stability here, if possible. They're still looking to raise authority as well, which doesn't look like that's really being directly impacted here. What do I think the odds are of a call for unity working out? Good enough to give it a shot. Yeah, I'd probably go for that too. Makes sense. Does afford us the plus one stability as well. Pay a scholar to help him recover his memory. A scholar from Quail University quickly arrives. She checks the sailor's throat, pokes and prods his head with calipers, and makes him inhale a foul-smelling vapor. This is the most serious case of memory loss I've seen in a long time. Technically, this man should be a gibbering mess on the floor. I'm right here. Your Majesty, I need more time to handle this. Uh-oh. No more rebelling for you. You're enjoying a peaceful breakfast when the Archbishop barges into your dining hall, waving a scrap of paper. Your Majesty, this is an outrage! This was nailed to the door of the cathedral this morning by some two-bit priest called Smote Lemongrave. It's an essay decrying the church, making all sorts of fantastical accusations. Outrageous. He claims we're corrupt just because we're selling a premium ticket to the Kushy Afterlife at 100 gold a pop. Yeah, I've seen this one too. I know you don't like your hat. What should be done about this troublesome priest and his criticisms of the church? Maybe? Seems likely, yeah. Yeah. Support across the board again. Of course, the grandees, more or less forced into this option. Rebellion's gonna happen though, Baer. Yeah. But at least I won't be poor. I might be dead, but I'll be buried with my money, damn it. Before the end of the day, Smote Lemongrave is tied to a stake in the city square. As the flames lick at his feet, he shouts that his words will not die with him. He's right. A splinter faction of the church uses the newfangled printing press to churn out thousands of copies of the so-called Martyr's Missive. Lemongrave's criticisms ring true to the peasantry, especially in light of his persecution. Maybe selfishness is bad? Maybe even worse than being an elf? Soon there are widespread riots across the kingdom, and the church is widely scorned as venal and corrupt. Well, there's the rebellion back. Auction time. Cathedral will increase faith. Fortress will increase military. Deer Park to lower farming, Monument to increase authority, Prison to decrease stability, and Theater to decrease the authority. You've got a little money now, right? Well, not the chiefs. But the counts, the nobles, they got a little cash. A really smart whale rocking the one single coin. Respect. Yeah, chief's hurting a little financially. So far, the monument easily leading the way here. Count's feeling pretty comfortable there.
seems an increase for Chief's military is fairly likely as well. Unless, sneaky. Had some grandees hanging on to extra contributions at the end. Get some funding for the prison. Decrease our stability a little more. All right. Currently rebelling are the Chiefs of the North. Rebellion! At long last, the Chiefs have reached their boiling point. You're confronted in your throne room by Chief Chivalrous Arcanus, his tattoos seeming to shift in the light of the braziers. The Chiefs of the North will rip that false crown from your head and stomp it into the mud. We'll be fighting for glory, for honor, and for Orm, the true monarch. This is a formal declaration of war. The next time we see each other, we'll be on the battlefield. I suppose I gotta do that. There'll be many heads on spikes before this war is over. Mine will not be among them. Treasonous defiance. Authority is now mocked. Chief Chivalrous Arcanus strides from your throne room without looking back. How did things get this bad? Urge to murder rising. What are our chances? We're boned? So be it. About my heir. Let's see how we're gonna go about getting a kid. Oh, we gotta take care of the fight first, right? Too long have those bastards in the Crownlands held us down. Too long have they called us heathens and mocked our way of life. That's not wrong. Aye! Now is the time to take up our axes and fight back. Morgana is with us. We'll burn their churches and string up their lying priests. Aye! Now I ask you, brave chiefs of the free north, where will we strike first? We can launch a preemptive strike against the counts to cripple their military capabilities. If we suspect the grandees may join our cause, we can call them to war. They'll be more likely to join us if the queen's authority is low. Or finally, we could send off an assassin to nip this in the bud. Dishonorable, of course, but convenient. Oh my. Well, the Chief's opening options are looking quite good. Launch a preemptive strike on the counts, they say. I don't know how the counts feel about that. I suspect bad. The chiefs launch a surprise attack on the east, slashing and burning their way across fields and farmlands. They catch a regiment of the Eastern Army unaware and spring an ambush, slaughtering them to a man. Common folk whisper that the battleground will be stained red for a generation. The gods are good. Down with the queen. Northern soldiers return home in triumph, leaving the East devastated in their wake. Ow! The South swells with devotees from across the kingdom. They've come to see Chris, the Ninth Herald, in action. Some even take to the fields in service of their would-be monarch, filling the southern storehouses. In the picturesque town of Arinjar, the Grandee's holy claimant delivers a speech to raucous applause. Two figures stand in an alcove nearby. If our army were strong enough, we could use the chaos of the rebellion to our advantage and take the palace by force. A crusade? That sounds promising. Though I suggest we leave it up to the Ninth God. Surely he will intervene on Chris's behalf. How should the grandees put Chris on the throne? Raise their own military or raise their own faith? I don't think they need 30 seconds for this one. Yeah, pretty clear choice here. Anybody feel like being the dissenting voice? There you go, Cerinthus. Pure bravery at its finest.
Let us join in prayer, fellow grandees. The end of Queen Louise's illegitimate, godless rule is upon us. We need only wait for a miracle. They must raise their faith to 10. Oh, boy. I think we just gotta hang out here. Yeah, I don't think I can do this either way. I can't afford to bribe him, and I can't afford to... Can't afford to piss him off. Don't treat your loyalists too poorly. It's the one time I actually have to consider it. Hey, look, the Count's got some money, though. You could spare just, like, a little bit, right? You can give me just, like, a... Like a little money. Just like a little money. There we go. You don't need all of it. A great battle. Vast armies darken the landscape like the shadows of clouds. Flags are flying. Drums are pounding in rhythm with the marching of boots. The kingdom is gripped with civil war! At least that's what you imagine. Most of your time is spent on the safety of your palace, poring over a giant map with your marshal. Your Majesty, the Army of the North is advancing on the capital, led by that treacherous cur, Chief Undead Hippo. I've received word from the commander of our loyalist forces in the south. If they march now, they'll intercept the chiefs in a matter of days. Alternatively, they could join forces with the Army of the East. It's risky, but together they'd have a higher chance of defeating the accursed chiefs. What are your orders, Your Majesty? The grandees and counts should join forces. Against us. Hopefully they'll do as they're told. Yeah, no, I'm sure they will. I'm sure they'll decide to follow orders blindly. Yeah, look, I'm not too hopeful for my own success here. But we'll see how it goes. Although I'm not gonna lie, if I were a grandee right now, I'd probably be voting B as well. Does seem like the best move at the moment. The whole city holds its breath. You stew in your palace, waiting for your marshal's return. Finally, she arrives at your throne room, looking perfectly composed. Your Majesty, as you ordered, the grandees have turned their army around to link up with the counts. All according to plan. It'll all come down to the next battle, Your Majesty. The fate of the kingdom hangs in the balance. We will prevail. Over the next few weeks, it becomes clear the Southern Army's retreat has given the chiefs free rein to pillage and plunder the South. The rampaging Northern troops descend on farms like locusts, taking everything to feed thousands of hungry soldiers. Meanwhile, shops, churches, and manors are plundered, and the stolen loot shipped back to the North. Literally just taking the money straight from the grandees' pockets. That is a massive transfer of wealth. Wow. While the South suffers, the Southern forces successfully link up with the Counts. Now the joint army of the Grandees and the Counts rush to meet the chiefs in open warfare. And the winner will either end your reign or preserve it. But first, a wedding! Your Majesty, your insistence on marrying this commoner is most unwise! If you proceed, it will be against the recommendations of all of your advisors. Didn't ask, don't care. Very well, in that case, I suppose all that remains is to make the announcement. Make the announcement in a public speech to the common folk. Yes. When you deliver the news to the masses, they raise their voices in a cheer so loud it shakes the podium. It's a fairy tale romance, and the common folk love it. The nobles, on the other hand, are furious. Especially because you refuse to even tell them in person. You're destroying centuries of tradition! All because you've gone moon-eyed over some gold-digging peasant? Shameful! Now that the news has been broken, the only thing left is to organize the royal wedding itself. Yay, fun! You remember that shipwreck that was found in the north, Your Majesty? With the fellow who lost his memory? The very one. We're having trouble with troops near the site on Chief Taladian's land. One of my squads was captured wandering about disoriented, muttering nonsense. Who knows what information they've accidentally given to the enemy? I've warned my people to stay away. Noted. While playing a game of chess in an austere castle, two counts of the East discussed their schemes against the crown. Drakov's bones! The queen must get a better grip on the kingdom, otherwise our plans fall apart! The count's aim is to raise authority to at least 5. Oh, interesting. Monarch's golden choice returns. I do feel personal wealth may be a pretty strong sway here. Let's go for that. All right. Oh boy. Captured loyalist. Good news, workshops. In my latest sortie, I captured a key leader of the loyalist forces. A scourge on you, exile hussar. You poxy snollygoster. Holy shit. Hold on.
Snollygoster.
Oh, man.
Snollygoster.
One more time.
Snollygoster.
That's the best word I've heard in years. That is the best individual word I have heard uttered in a good long while.
Snollygoster.
Wow. A shrewd, unprincipled person, especially a politician. It's the perfect word. I'm so excited about this word. What does poxy even mean? Never heard that either. Insignificant, too small, or bad in some other way. One who has the pox, right, of course. Poxy Snollygoster! Someone gag our guest. I'm tired of listening to his wittering. That's better. Now can we hear ourselves think? So workshops, what shall we do with our prize? What should the chiefs do with Grandy Cerinthus, their prisoner of war? Oh my goodness. Open to chiefs of the north only. I've never snollygosted in my life. Yeah, that's just what a snollygoster would say. I don't think I'm even saying it right anymore. No, I got it. You poxy snollygoster. Extract key information from him by any means necessary. Where is your honor, you dogs? I am a prisoner and a noble. Grandy Cerinthus is dragged away and handed over to an expert interrogator who asks very pointed questions. Before Grandy Cerinthus expires, he gives up some most useful information about southern troop movements. Information which the chiefs put to good use, ambushing a column of soldiers and slaughtering them to a man. Word of Grandy Cerinthus' poor treatment soon spreads back to the south. This only serves to draw the Grandys closer to the queen. No more rebellion for the Grandys. Super duper handsome. You sure are, converting that sub. Welcome on into the pile. Bear hugs for him, please. Appreciate it. The Civil War casts a shadow over your wedding, but loyal commoners take to the streets to show their support. Many nobles refuse to attend the wedding. Even those loyal to you are still furious you'd marry a commoner. But when you walk down the aisle to see Jay waiting by the altar, their face lit up by the most radiant smile, suddenly nothing else matters. Do you take this person as your lawfully wedded spouse? I do. Then I pronounce you wife and spouse. After the wedding, of course, there's a feast. The nobles refuse to speak to Jay, preferring to mutter among themselves about their low-born status. By the time you find yourself alone with Jay, it's past midnight and you've never felt more tired. So here we are at last. Married after all these years of sneaking around, can you believe it? I knew everything would work out for the best, as you can see all around us. What did you do to get the nobles to agree to this? Well, they hate me now. Well, I love you. And I'm the royal consort now, which means I'm far more important than they are. Care to join me in bed? No time like the present. Let's go fuck. They swig back the last dregs of their wine and lead you to bed. This is a lot fancier than my old cottage. The final battle. A month ago, battle was averted, but that battle cannot be postponed forever. The grandees and counts are all that stands between the chiefs and the capital. A final battle deciding the fate of the kingdom. I'll send word to the counts that it's time to strike. We can only hope they listen to our orders, Your Majesty. Well, here it is, counts. Should you obey orders? Send the joint forces of the counts and grandees to fight the rebels? Or hang back, let the chiefs march on the capital without challenge? The coward's way out, I might add. They failed to include that part with option B. Fully dishonorable, no question. Glad to see they at least are willing to fail. Yeah. When she finally returns, it's not in the manner you'd hoped. She's carried into your throne room on a stretcher, coughing weakly. Her torso is covered in blood-soaked bandages. What took you so long? Took a few licks in the battle. Docs patched me up. We caught the chiefs in a classic pincer movement. The counts attacked from one side and the grandees charged in from the other. But the chiefs had occupied a highly defensible hilltop. In my arrogance, I thought our combined forces were enough. But they'd prepared a few surprises of their own. Hidden archers, burning oil, a feigned retreat. But suddenly turned back around and hit us where it hurt. They pulled out all the stops. It was a slaughter. All I remember is blood and screams, so much death. When they found me, I was under a pile of corpses with 6 arrows in me. They say it's a miracle I survived it all. How could this happen? If we want to see the year's end, we must build up fortifications, stockpile food, train them. I feel like they won already. Is it not over? It should be over. If it's not already over, that's kind of silly. Okay, yeah, they won. The sun rises on a city in turmoil. The chiefs began their assault last night, and since then you've heard nothing outside but screams and howls and the clash of blades. Half the capital is in flames. Soldiers rush back and forth, shouting panicked orders. You haven't seen your marshal since the night before. Perhaps she's already dead. Your honor guard are in the streets outside the palace, building a barricade and organizing last-ditch defenses. Vital work, but you're vulnerable without them by your side. The royal court is empty except for you and your spouse. If they break in, we can't let them take us alive. We'll go down fighting. You're right. I'll fetch my rapier. You wait and stew. Outside, the screams and clashes get louder. Finally, your spymaster arrives, out of breath, her face stained by smoke and blood. They'll be here any moment, Your Majesty. You must saddle your horse and escape the city. No, I will stand and fight with my lover. It was nice knowing you, Your Majesty. She's gone in the blink of an eye, no turning back now. That's the woman I married. You walk down the palace steps, your feet slipping on all the blood. A wounded watchman crawls past you, begging for water. The sky is aflame with a deep, malevolent glow. You turn to your southern spouse. If you have anything to say, now's the time. Whoop that trick! Yes, let's kill the bastards. A column of hardened northern warriors advance down the road, roaring and waving their battle axes. Chief Undead Hippo is at their head, shouting orders. Come and get some, you bastards! Charge! You and your spouse charge forward, weapons raised. It's beautiful. It's glorious. It will go down in the history books forever. It's over almost instantly. A dozen battle axes chop you into dog food. A thousand heavy boots march over you, crushing you into paste. But for a moment there, you really felt like a queen. Was it the moment when I was chopped into dog food? Successor voting? Oh shit! Who shall it be? Vote for either Count Mara of the East or Chief Orm of the North. The grandees, ultimately with the final say here, unsurprisingly, spitefully voting out Chief Orm.
That's hilarious. Somehow the counts still win. Count Mara. Appointed to the throne. Queen Louise's last doomed glorious charge against the chiefs would go down in history. Not as an especially smart move, but a brave one. The chiefs, led by undead Hippo, launched a rebellion that toppled the queen and devastated the kingdom. But when the dust cleared, they weren't quick or strong enough to seize the throne themselves. Quick or strong, got you on both counts. As a reward for staying loyal to the queen, the top grandees were beheaded. In public, the survivors swore loyalty to the new regime. In private, they swore vengeance. The counts joined the rebellion alongside the chiefs. In the aftermath, they were the natural choice to take the crown, and Mara was crowned to half-hearted cheers from the traumatized common folk. What a mess. At least we got to be with Jay for a day, right? The counts reign supreme. Congratulations, Keto, on being the poorest noble. Yet another kingdom in disarray. This whole rule was an absolute disaster. Unquestionably, yeah. But it was fun.